That's that word of faith stuff I was telling you about.
I got you. Good morning, everybody. It is a pleasure, beyond a pleasure, beyond a privilege to be here. It is my family. As Pastor Josh will tell you, I come here and I just cry. Like, there's the Spirit of God is here. You guys are super privileged to have the Spirit of God moving in this church as it does. You know, I have a bit of a testimony up, but I'm not even going to get into that. I just want to let you know that the Lord healed me from my stupidity. And I want to give a little bit of credit, not too much, because I might go to his head, Brother Bruce, because while I was in college, while I was first coming here, I just started going to college. I was so hungry for the word. The Spirit of God really just overtook me. They used to call me Manifesto, yeah. But I was so hungry for the word. I remember we did the first fruit prayers, where at the first week of every month, we would do 6 a.m. prayer. And I don't know, God was like, you got to go, man. This is, you know what I mean? You get to pray with, like, the leaders of the church. You get to pray about anything, everything, you know. And I have some great testimonies about that. I remember I came, it was a Wednesday morning. I prayed to get a job, and then that afternoon I had a job. It was crazy. Yeah, it was. Yeah, that prayer time was amazing for me. Not only that, but what really got me was just that there was Bible study at 8 a.m., which the guys in the men's home would know. So I would go have prayer at 6, and then go 8 a.m. To get some Bible with me, because I needed it. I was hungry. And Brother Bruce was able to encourage me, even if I came out with something dumb, you know. He was able to gently push me towards the right direction and teach us and grow us. And it just made me hungry for the word. And I used to go to, I'm still currently enrolled in RAC, going to be doing some online stuff. But when I was on campus, man, I'm a fresh believer. I would talk to everybody and tell them about Jesus, tell them about how good he is, tell them about giving their life to Jesus. And honestly, I felt reckless. Like, I look back at it now, I'm like, I can't believe. I would just talk to people, let them know. I've had people come up to me, you know, and encourage me, like, oh, I can't believe you're sharing the word of God the way you are. You know, I've been saved a month. You know, I'm just trying to tell somebody about Jesus. That's how I felt. I was so happy. I was so excited about this this Spirit of God that you get to partake of, and we all get to partake of together. And it's such a blessing, and it's so amazing. So talking about school, I just want to talk to you guys on a real level. I mean, I had an awesome time in high school. And the reason I had an awesome time in high school, I had a lot of the same friends throughout the years. I'm not going to say I was super smart, but I was in decent classes, you know, and I had some good influences. I had a buddy of mine, Manny. And so me, Manny, and my boy Jesus, we would always be in the same classes. And we were, like, pretty solid together. Like, we'd joke around in class. We all got good grades. We did our thing. But every time it came to a presentation, we would work on it literally maybe an hour. And every time we had our presentation, we would kill it. And we would do awesome. We would kill it, honestly. And it was because I believe we knew our parts. Yeah. All right. My bad. Sorry. So we would kill it. Manny, he was really good at drawing a crowd. He would just, like, let everybody know, hey, look, this was going down. Bring everybody to attention. He would do our intro. I was really good at PowerPoints. Didn't make one today, though. Didn't feel like it. And I was really good filler. I was really good in the middle. I love speaking in the middle because I could just fill up, you know, some time. And my boy Jesus, he's really soft-spoken, and he was really good at just letting it drop and, you know, ending it. So we all knew our position, we all knew our parts, and we would always kill it. We would do awesomely. Now I come to college, and I'm thinking, man, presentations, I ain't got no problem with this. I got this, you know, no problem. Anyway, I get in a group with 3 women. I'm the only guy. It was terrible. I mean, it was terrible. Our first meeting, we're talking about, you know, how we're going to strategize, how we're going to do this. But real quickly, it went into, oh, what are we going to wear? Oh, what? You know, we're allowed to bring food that day. What are we going to bring? What are you going to make? And I'm there like, I just want to get this project finished. And to put on top of that, I love doing the PowerPoints. So I volunteered, but another one of my classmates wanted to do the PowerPoint. And, I mean, majority of the time, women get their way, so. Plus, it's 3-1, so I was like, just got to do it. So, but she was cool about it. She let everybody pick the information on what they wanted to speak on, which is what we did. So we contributed to the PowerPoint. And I think women are a little bit more team-oriented than guys, but I'm going to let that one go. Anyway, so it came to be like, all right, so I worked a lot, and I couldn't go to every single meeting, nor did I really want to go to every single meeting, because we would always end up talking about what are we going to wear, what are we going to eat, what are we going to bring. It was terrible. And anyway, so these women, they felt neglected. They felt like I wasn't part of the team. So what they did is they rallied together, and they emailed my teacher and let her know that I wasn't doing my part. Now, I sent the information of which I wanted to speak on, so that I thought that was my only part. Everything else was, hey, what are you going to wear? How are you going to put your hair up? How are you going to, what are you going to, it was terrible. I mean, for me, personally. The women loved it, I'm sure. But, so they rallied together to this female teacher. I didn't know. But the teacher, she was super nice. She actually emailed us all. And she told the women, how immature are you to come to me directly rather than speak to him about what he's doing and try to resolve it within yourselves before escalating it to me. And they were even trying to say, like, oh, we shouldn't give Edgar the credit for his part because he wasn't at the meetings and stuff. Anyway, so she came back at them hard, called them immature, called them that we, you know, told us that we need to work through this together, which we did. Presentation day came. They put me in the middle. That's my spot. I was happy about that. Like, cool, all right, let's do this. And, you know, it opened up, it was kind of okay. I spoke, and the thing that killed me was, I mean, we did a good job, I'm not gonna lie. But the thing that really killed me was the women that went after me, the two other girls that went after me, they were just like, oh yeah, just like Edgar said, and it bothered me, because I was like, you know, oh, earlier you're here trying to stab me in the back, and now you see that I actually have skills for this, because I actually went, sixth grade, I went to a magnet school. They don't have them anymore, but they made you do a presentation in every single class. You know, English, social studies, history, every math, you had to do a presentation. So they trained me up to do presentations. I was pretty good at it. So I liked doing PowerPoints. I was trained to do it. So I was okay at it. I was pretty good. But they were just like, oh, Edgar, just like Edgar said. And it bothered me. But looking back on it now, I realize that it was just God being real nice to me and showing me, like, yeah, you have this gift that even if you're in a bad team, if you're doing your part and doing your thing and walking in the giftings that I've given you, you're going to come out okay. Yeah. So that's what I'm going to speak about today. I'm going to talk about some gifts, some spiritual gifts. We're going to be getting into 1 Corinthians 12. And I just want to try this out. Ears. Hearts. Oh, yeah, that's pretty good. Lord, by the confession of their mouths, Father, their ears are open, their hearts are ready. May they receive this word. May you be in full control. And may you change someone's life today. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Alrighty. So we're going to go through 1 Corinthians 12. I'll read through the whole thing because I really love the whole thing. And I'm a real strong, how do I say this? The word preaches itself. And I know it does because I read it. No, I'm just kidding. All right, I'm going to let it go. But do you read it? No, I'm just kidding. I'm going to let it go. Does that work? All right. So we're going to start at 1 Corinthians 12, right at the beginning. Hopefully everybody's there. I don't know if he put it up there probably. But all right. So this is New King James because we're grown-ups here. Come on, guys. No, I'm just All right. Now, concerning spiritual gifts, brethren, I do not want you to be ignorant. You know, and not the ghetto ignorant, like not knowing ignorant. Sorry, that's me. All right. You know that you were Gentiles, carried away to these dumb idols. However, you were led. Therefore, I make known to you that no one speaking by the Spirit of God calls Jesus accursed. And no one can say that Jesus is Lord except by the Holy Spirit. Now, there are diversities of gifts. There are differing gifts, but the same Spirit. There are differences of ministries, but the same Lord. And there are diversities of activities, but it is the same God who works in all of them. But the manifestation of the Spirit is given to each one for the profit of all. For to one is given the word of wisdom through the Spirit, to another word of knowledge through the same Spirit, to another faith by the same Spirit, to another gifts of healing by the same Spirit, to another the working of miracles, to another prophecy, to another discerning spirits, to another different kinds of tongues, to another interpretation of tongues. But one and the same Spirit works all these things, distributing to each one individually as he wills. I'm going to stop right here and just kind of talk on these, this first section here. I love how much it's emphasizing. This is Paul here writing to church, to Corinthians church. And it's just so emphasized that it's the same Spirit. He repeatedly says, same Spirit. There's one Lord. It's the same Lord. Don't look at what this church is doing over here and this church is doing over here. Don't worry about what your brother's doing over here, what this brother's doing over here. As long as they're doing it for the Lord, know that he's involved. Know that he's in control. So this is my three parts. What I'm going to be hitting on is being a part of Christ, knowing your part, and walking your part. So right here, being a part. So I want to start with verse number 3 right here. Therefore, I make known to you that no one speaking by the Spirit of God calls Jesus accursed, and no one can say that Jesus is Lord except by the Holy Spirit. We need to accept, especially us evangelical type people, that even though you're telling someone about Jesus, it's up to Jesus to save them. It's his choice. Well, of course he wants everyone, but I'm going to let that go. All right, anyway. So that's where I wanted to start at. Salvation is where this starts. You need to be in that. You need to be part of him. You need to be in Christ. Now, verse 7. But the manifestation of the Spirit is given to each one for the profit of all. We need to understand that these spiritual gifts are not for ourselves to be puffed up. It's not for us to say, oh, look how well I do this or that for God. No, it's solely, oh, I'm doing this for God and for others. And God is going to empower you to do these things for others. You're not left alone. God is helping you. That's why they're spiritual gifts. It's his Spirit influencing and helping you out, which is going to my last verse that I'm going to touch on in this section, is verse 11, which I already kind of went over. But all one and the same Spirit works all these things, distributing to each one individually as he wills. So understand, these gifts that you have, they're all great, and I'm just about to get over into them. Knowing your part. All right, so as you've seen here, we are of one Spirit. We are all of God. We are, if we are in Christ, if we are saved by grace, if we are, you know, had our confession of faith, you need to know you are part of his Spirit. He allows you to enter into his family, and you're part. So now I'm going to go into verse 12 and read on a bit. So this scripture is talking about the body of Christ and how we are the body of Christ. For as the body is one and has many members, but all members of that one body being many are one body, so also is Christ. Oh yeah. For also is Christ. For by one Spirit we were all baptized into one body. Whether Jews or Greeks, whether slaves or free, no matter who you are, you can be baptized into this Spirit, into this body. And have all been made to drink into one Spirit. For in fact, the body is not one member, but many. If the foot should say, because I am not a hand, I am not of the body, is it therefore not of the body? And if the ear should say, because I am not an eye, I am not of the body, is it therefore not the body? If the whole body were an eye, where would be the hearing? If the whole were hearing, where would be the smelling? But now God has set the members, each one of them, in the body just as he pleased. And if they were all one member, where would the body be? But now indeed there are many members, yet one body. And the eye cannot say to the hand, I have no need for you. Nor again the head to the feet, I have no need for you. Nor much rather those members of the body which seem to be weaker are necessary. And those members of the body which think to be less honorable, on these we bestow greater honor. And our unpresentable parts have greater modesty, but our presentable parts have no need. I'm just going to kind of stop in the middle of that section. The body has many members. I mean, you can just see it. You got your muscles, your ligaments, your bones, you got your skin, you got all that good jazz. But the funny thing is, we have problems, just as it's saying here, with understanding that no matter what part of the body you are, you're important. And it's really hard for us to get that. For me personally, I'm speaking from personal experience, it is very hard for me to get this. But I think it's real fun. I sprained my ankle the other day playing football. Now, ankles, they're so easy to get sprained. I don't know if it's just me, but like ankles are so easy to get sprained. It's ridiculous. And ankles are such a small part of your body. But if you don't have your ankles, you can't walk. You know, it's so small, but it's so significant. And that's what I see here in the scriptures. The weaker parts are not only important, but it's saying like the most important. They're necessary. You need them. So understand, if you're an ankle, we need you. People have issues at times serving, and that's a gift. That's a gift you have, to be a servant. But you need to understand, even though you feel like a servant, you might feel like a peasant, you might feel like you're doing so much work and no one sees that you've done so much, you're not getting the credit for this or that, you need to understand that the Lord sees. Amen. He knows. He knows what you're good at. And if you know that what you're good at, you don't need to worry about what anybody else thinks because you know you're good at it. And you know that you're giving it to him. And when you give it to him, it's so amazing because if you're giving him your gift, if you're allowing him to work through any giftings you think are you're like, oh, I'm just good at this. No, you're not just good at this. He made you for this.
That's right.
So all parts matter. I want us to get that in our spirits. Every part matters. The body cannot function if it doesn't have every single part. So I was just thinking, this is a little bit of an illustration. If you're looking at a team, right? So I was talking about my groups earlier and how it was kind of disheveled and everything. You know, let's say, basketball team, you got what is it, wing, flat, center, or point, sorry, point. So you got all these, what if you don't have a point? You know, I think the rest could kind of, you know, you might be a man short, but, you know, you might be able to make up for it. It might be a hard game. You might even win it. But it's hard because not every piece of the team is there with you working together for that goal. But when you're working together, it's more effective. It's stronger. Just as me, when I was in that group in high school, it was so smooth. It was so fluid. It was so effective. I didn't have to worry about the outcome. Versus I was in a team in college where I was worried about the outcome, thought I was going to fail, you know what I mean? But God works everything for his glory, and he works everything for the good of us, should I say. He works everything for our good, because now I can use it as a testimony to let you know, in that moment, I didn't feel like a good speaker, because I was speaking to these women, and they weren't hearing me, you know? But I know that God's gifted me with being able to communicate well. So I'm going to start finishing up this chapter here. but our presentable parts have no need. Okay. But God composed the body, having given greater honor to that part which lacks it, that there should be no schism in the body, but that the members should have the same care for one another. And if one member suffers, all members suffer with it. Or if one member is honored, all the members rejoice with it. I just think of like the Super Bowl, you know. People are going through the season, fighting for that Super Bowl spot. And the cool thing is, the thing that I love the most about Super Bowl is the food, honestly. I love the food. It's amazing. It's always fun to hang out with family, too. But the best part is when your team won, you rejoice, too. You weren't even in the mission. You weren't in the battle, but you're like, yeah. Woo! Rejoicing, having fun. You weren't even in the battle, but you're part of the family. You're part of the unit, you know? That's kind of how it is with Christ, but we have a problem with that. We see, look at this young guy. Oh, why don't Pastor ask me to preach? What am I doing? Why are you worried about me? Why are you worried about me? But and to go scriptural, you're looking at Peter's talking to Jesus talking to Jesus when he was restoring him, when they're eating fish together, and he's letting him know, yo, Peter, you're going to die for me. Peter goes, what about John? What's John going to do? He's like, what is it to you if I let him live till I come back? What are you worried about him for? Why are you worried about him, her, this ministry, that ministry, this person at work, that person at work, this person in your family, that person in your family? Let them do them and do you and know that you're doing all right, especially because you're here and you're in his will. No matter what you're doing, you're filling bags for pantry? Hallelujah. Who's rejoicing? Who's rejoicing? For filling bags. Who's rejoicing for filling bags? Come on now. I remember filling bags. I remember coming here and helping fill bags and going to Faith Kitchen and wondering what I'm doing, you know, going to Brother Bruce's Bible study. He even encouraged me to start my own Bible study. That Bible study failed. Be honest. People weren't committed. People weren't in it. People weren't trying to be part of the group, part of the unit, trying to work towards a common goal. So it failed. But what I do? Oh, man, I'm not made for this. Nah. I'm going to praise Jesus because I experienced that, because I experienced them failures. Amen. Hallelujah. Another thing, I'm still in college, you know what I mean? But when I was on campus, I'm telling people about Jesus. I remember this girl, man. I'm telling her about Jesus, telling her, man, you don't even know what I've been through, telling her my testimony, letting her know, like, God saved me. God let me know about his love. She grew up in church talking about, oh, I ain't with that. I don't like that, da-da-da-da. She's like, I like science. I believe in science. Science explains the world for me. I told her, all right, I'm going to give you a science experiment. How about you pray to God for a week, and I bet he'll deliver. Who got faith like that? Come on. Come on. You know what she said? I don't want to treat God like a science experiment. Not too long ago, you didn't want to have nothing to do with God. Why not treat him like a science experiment? Go for it. What was it going to be for you? I even asked, I'm like, you know what? I'm going to pray for you. She's like, no, don't pray for me. Don't pray for me. I was like, I'm going to pray for you. I'm praying for you when I get home. It was hilarious, but where I had, you know, this where I got recognition, there was this guy, kid you not, my dude anointed in his mother's womb. Grew up in church. He came up to me. He's a security guard. I'm like, man, what, have I done anything? Oh, man. He came up to me. He said, you know, I heard you, you know, telling this girl about Jesus, and I just wanted to commend you, you know, brother, for stepping out in faith that way, and that. I'm like, man, I've been saved 3 months. I don't know what you thought. Isn't this what we're supposed to do? No. Yes. You ain't telling someone about how good Jesus is to you? No. You cheating on him? You know what I'm saying? When you got, like, my wife, I'll tell you how nice she is to me, how good she is to me. I ain't going to get too deep into it right now, but I'm going to let you know because she treat me well. I enjoy her. Are you in that relationship with Jesus? Can you say, oh, he treat me well, you know? Oh, you're going through this? Let me pray for you. How about that? Instead of looking at somebody like, oh, you going through that? Oh, I'm good. I'm with Jesus. Jesus is like, no, go back. You're supposed to help them. You're supposed to pray for them. You're supposed to support them, encourage them, bring them up, raise them up, help them out. Oh, they ain't saved? Well, how about you try to let them know about me? If they don't have that open window, if they don't know, how will they ever come to him? It just ain't going to happen. But anyway, this guy comes up to me, and he lets me know, oh, man, it's so amazing you're coming out, telling Jesus, telling about Jesus, da-da-da-da. Cool, you know, we start talking, spieling. Intelligent dude, you know what I mean? I love him, cool dude. I see him a little bit later, and I think I was, well, I don't know, I was feeling good that day, though. I mean, I'm telling you, when you're walking out and you're preaching about Jesus, you're telling everybody about Jesus, your day is awesome. Just like Pastor Joy said, I kid you not, it works. And it was, I mean, I was walking by blind faith. They call me Manifesto for plenty of reasons, but it was, I was just outlandish in my faith. I shared with everybody, Pastor CJ shared one time, I was walking in 0 degree weather to make it to the first fruit prayer and to get my Bible study on, and it was 0 degree weather, below 0 degree weather, you know, just to get the word because I was that hungry. You don't think people are that hungry? If they don't know, you can't, you know what I mean? But what is it? Closed mouth don't get fed. Come on, my fridge is full. Let me let you know. You know what I mean? So this kid was looking. This kid was looking down, you know, and I went up to him, you know, and I was telling someone about Jesus, arguing with someone because he was like, "Oh, you're too Old Testament." I said, "What do you think Jesus preached?" And then after that, I ran into someone else, tell them about Jesus and how he was transforming my life. Walked to this brother, anointed in the womb, looking depressed. Hey, bro, what's going on? I didn't bash him. Oh, yeah, he's anointed in the womb. Yeah, he was raised in church. Yeah, he knows more Bible than me. But he was looking down. So what'd I do? Oh, bro, can I pray for you? Can I pray for you? Yeah, yeah. He can sing. I can't sing. I know he could preach. Haven't heard him, but I know he can. Because he'd be preaching to me, I'd ask him for advice. I feel like he'd give better advice to me because he got the word, like, you know what I mean? Like, my wife, she got the word downloaded. I say something, she'd be like, oh, yeah, that's in 1 Corinthians. I'm just trying to talk to you. You know, why are you throwing Bible in my face? Or you talk to Pastor Josh, you don't talk to him. You're trying to dig a hole in Scripture like, oh, man, this is so good. I'm trying to dig into Scripture. He's like, but did you think about this? Throws a dynamite in your hole. And you're like, I didn't want the hole to be that big, man. I just was trying to dig a little. Oh, come on. But I love that. I love that family, that community, that love that we share with one another. And that's what we need to have. We need to understand, not that, I mean, Pastor Josh, God bless you, man. You know a lot of stuff. You know a lot of things. You know a lot of things. I ain't going there, though. It's too much for me. I ain't swallowing that pill. That's too much. So I kind of was dripping in the walk in your part. But here, let me wrap this up here. Now, you are the body of Christ and members individually. And God has appointed these in the church. First apostles, second prophets, third teachers. After that, miracles, then gifts of healing, helps, which is servant. I was telling you about that. Helps. You know, I'm again, let me know. Administrations, varieties of tongues. Are all apostles? No. Are all teachers? Nah, not really. Are all workers of miracles? I haven't seen myself do anything crazy, personally. But maybe I will in Africa. Come on, somebody. Do all have gifts of healing? Do all speak with tongues? Do all interpret tongues? Don't worry about all that. Earnestly desire the best gifts. And yet, I show you a more excellent way. You know what I find? I find when you're walking in your gift and you're doing your thing and you look at someone else like, dang, I wish I could be kind of like that. And God's just like, keep doing your thing. Keep doing your thing. And one day you walk into what you wanted to do and you walk into a different spiritual gift and you're like, whoa, I wanted that. Like, I know. Doesn't it feel better here? Yeah, because I mean, exactly. Don't worry about it. Follow what you're doing. Follow the gift God has already apportioned to you. He's given you a measure of faith so you can work in a spiritual gift to touch a spiritual atmosphere, to transform a spiritual atmosphere, to turn up the heat, could I say, in a spiritual atmosphere, in a certain avenue. He's using you a certain way. See, the path is narrow, and you're worried about someone else's narrow path. You don't know what they're going through. You don't know what they're looking at. You don't know how hard their path is. But earnestly desire the best gifts. I want you guys to understand, walking your part means that you are part of something greater. Know that. You might be walking your little path and thinking, oh, well, their path looks better. Well, keep doing your thing because every part is important and you are part of something that's greater than yourself. Desire the greater gifts. It's not bad to look at someone and be like, man, I want to be just like them. I want to be, you know what I mean? Like, Pastor Josh's gift of just knowing too much. I kind of want to know a little bit more, but not too much, you know. But yeah, you know, I would like some, you know, or Brother Bruce. He's kind of mean sometimes, but he's you need to be. But he walks around with an authority. He's an uncle to me in the faith. I look at him as family, Pastor CJ family. You know, everyone here, and family, Richard, family, people who've transformed my life. I remember arguing with Richard when he first came in the home. I kid you not. And God corrected both of us. Quit. It's crazy. But that's how family's born. You argue, you fight through things, but you love through that. And now I'm coming to the greatest gift, John 15, 12 through 13. Now, in 1 Corinthians 13, you can read it for yourself, talks about these gifts mean nothing without love. But I want to reflect on John 15, 12 through 13. Let me just turn, you guys turn to it as I turn to it. Okay. This is my commandment. This is Jesus talking. It's in red, man. It's important. This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this, than to lay down one's life for his brother. Jesus literally did that. And what I love about, if you read into John 15, talks about in the beginning being connected to the true vine, which is the Father. Being connected to him, understanding that you're part of a greater whole. And if you're not, we'll get you there. If you, all you have to do is believe in him, believe that Jesus was or is, shall I say, because he died, rose again, still living, still moving. So you have to be a part of him. But he's saying, if you're part of me, this is my greatest commandment. Follow this. Come on, listen to this. This is what I command of you. Love one another as I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this, than to lay down one's life for his friends. And then the cool thing is, after this, and mind you, this is like pre-death, and Jesus is just spitting some truth here. He's talking about, you know, you lay down your life for your brother, and then he's talking about you are no longer called a servant because a servant doesn't know what his master's doing. No, you're now my friend, and you are into my family. You know what's going on. Anybody got those friends, you walk into their crib, open their fridge, crack open a soda, sit down on the couch, change the channel? That's family. That's what Jesus sees in you. He's like, come to my throne room of grace, take what you need, pray for what you need, and talks about that, how he'll give you anything you pray for, but you got to be connected to him. I want a Lamborghini, Jesus. No, I want life transformation. Yes. That's what I want. Amen. I want to transform lives, doing what I love to do, talk about Jesus, letting people know about Jesus, filling bags at food pantry, passing out food at Faith Kitchen. Yes. That's what I love. I'll never forget. Matter of fact, I lied about not seeing miracles. You want to hear a miracle I seen? For me, I know it was a miracle because I felt it in such a manner. There's this guy who came. I was doing Faith Kitchen, and you know, he would come. He spoke Spanish, broken English. And he came in a wheelchair first, telling me, "Yo, I love you guys. What you guys do here? You guys are family. Like, my family's all in Puerto Rico. My family's over here. You know, I'm literally by myself. You know, I don't care if he sells drugs. I don't care if he don't know Jesus the way I know Jesus. I don't care what level he's at. I don't care if he's a servant, this, that, that. I'm not worried about what his position is. I ain't worried about none of that. I was just talking to him, let him know. He was like, yeah, you know, you guys are so great. What you guys do here, you know, it feels like I'm eating with family. How awesome that is. The next time he comes with a cane. I'm like, bro, yo, what's going on? He's like, yeah, you know, I'm feeling a little better, you know. I've got this cane, you know, walking, feeling okay. I'm like, you all right, man? You don't need to say. He's like, nah, man, I feel good. Eating, standing up, holding a bag of stuff, feeling good, telling me how I feel, giving other people his food. He's like, oh, they ran out of pies. Oh, here, take my pie. No, don't worry. That's family. Next week after that, or the following Faith Kitchen, my dude didn't have no cane. I'm like, bro, you all right? Yeah, I'm feeling great, man. I'm feeling great. I don't care if you go to church or not. My dude went from a wheelchair to a cane to walking and handing people food and loving on people. And from what I saw, man, I miss my family, to, yo, I can't wait till Friday because I'm going to be with some family, some people who care about me, some people who love me. My roommate just stole from me, but, you know, I know here I can sit and be with family. That's what the church is about. And you think that's not a big deal? I saw what a big deal that was to that man, and probably still is. It's amazing. It's crazy. Life transformation. So here I am, kind of wrapping. This is my wrap up. There is something called divergence. I don't know if you've seen the movie. It's a good movie. It's all right. But let me tell you, divergence. I woke up from a dream. I ain't getting into that. But pretty much, so divergence, right? So how can I explain this? Divergence is a mathematical term, and pretty much is like an equation that has no, it's equal is infinity. So like pi, you know, 3.145, blah, 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 blah. That's like, that can be whatever the equation is for pi is like a divergent equation because it has no end, all right? So this is how I look at the body of Christ. This is how I look at God. He's an infinite being. He is infinite, always was, is, and is to come. Hey, hallelujah. Come on. Ray, wait, hold on. Rapture practice, right? No. I'm just messing around. All right. So he always is, always was, always will be. He's everything. He is infinite, but you're a part of him. Now, if you look at infinity, you know that it's continual numbers, right? Now, the cool thing is the number one is part of infinity. Infinity can't be without number one. Now, the cool thing is it can't be with number two either, because number two is pretty important. It's part of the sequence. But number two is a greater sum than number one. It's a bigger portion of infinity. So when we come into this body together, we start serving together, we start moving together, we are coming together as a greater portion of our infinite Father. Amen. When he said faith to move mountains, I remember when I read that, I can move mountains. Yeah, you can, man. Yeah. I mean, I don't know if it was literal. He just killed a tree, man. I don't know if you read that. He killed a tree. He was like, curse you, bam. But that's the power we walk around with. Peter walking on water. Anyone can walk on water. You have to have faith for it, though. And then when you rub against someone else's faith, I don't know if you've ever been there, you rub someone else's faith, you're like, oh, man, you got some crazy faith. And check this out. Scripture says he's a portion to us. In Corinthians 12, he's a portion to us each, a measure. He's given us a piece of his greatness. That's why not all can be apostles. That's not why all can be prophets. That's why. Because we need to have order. We need to have structure as the body has order and structure. Come on. Amen. Come on. So here's my 3 points of application for you. I'm going to let you know. You got to pick a team. What team you want? I'm going to let you know, Matthew 12:30. If you ain't with him, you against him. So if you ain't on Jesus' team, whose team are you? I'm going to let you know, not his. Sorry. If your feelings hurt, talk to Jesus. No, I'm just kidding. He'll heal you. He'll heal you. Number two, find your spot on the team. You might get drafted. I mean, he's drafting everybody every day. Come on. Ready. Come on. But if you don't know what part, oh, yeah, you know, am I really a quarterback? I don't know. You know, am I supposed to be the point? I'd rather sit on the bench. Fine, you can rejoice on the bench, but if you find your spot on the team, you become something greater, or a part of something greater, should I say. And maybe, you know what I mean, rub off on you. But anyway, pray. We will pray with you for this. If you come here, we'll help you to the altars when we start opening it up in a second. We'll pray for you to understand this, to receive this. If you don't know your part on the team, God will reveal it to you. Like I said, there's servants in here that I see. Julie, administration gift, too. You know what I mean? I'm going to throw that one out there, but servant? Crazy. Crazy servant. It's crazy. You can get that too. And if you need a little extra stuff, just 1 Corinthians 12. Read into it. Got you. And here's another one for you. You might have been walking in your gift for a while. You might know your position on the team. You might be first string quarterback, but are you helping the second and third string? Are you helping these up and coming people and encouraging them to walk out into their position, into the team, so they can be a part of something greater? Are you encouraging them? So right now, I want to open up the altars. If you receive something, shout amen, hallelujah, amen. Praise him. What you got to? Come on, somebody. Praise him. And I'm going to leave you with a benediction. May the Lord and bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. Jesus, give them peace today. Have a fire stir up in them as well. Something that brings them to this altar and says, God, there's something more to me following you. There's something more to me loving you. I know I'm part of this team, but Lord, I don't know my spot. Or Lord, I got my spot. I've been doing it for a minute. And I'm desiring greater gifts. I'm trying to walk out in something greater, but it hasn't come yet. Be patient. I got you. Come up to these altars. I know you got prayer partners. Come up. Megan, if you want, come up. Pray for you. We'll pray for you to understand your spot. Lord, help them understand their spot, Lord. Give them peace as they go out today. Whatever weights have been on them, Father, remove it. Whatever blinders are on their eyes, Lord, remove them. Lighten up your word to them. Lighten up your amazingness, your grace, your mercies, your infinite power, and how they're a part of this. In Jesus' name, amen.